Welcome to Marriage Strong. You're probably wondering where Marla and Corey are, or maybe the Fenders, Mark and Eliza. Well, we gave them the evening off and we said, you know what? We want to host Marriage Strong tonight. So my name is Angel and this is my husband, Matt, and we are actually the marriage pastors of Victory Church. We have the honor of being the marriage pastors at Victory. So welcome.
Absolutely. This is so cool. Hey, we're glad we have you guys on here tonight. If you thought you were coming on here in response to Johnson's message a couple of weeks ago, where he was talking about that we were doing a special Marriage Strong with Chip Judd, that was actually, I think it was the last week or the week before last we did that. And here's the thing, we actually have put all of our Marriage Strong videos, all the ones we've done months past.
Because you guys have been requesting this. You guys keep asking us, where are the videos of these things? We love them. Keep bringing them and keep letting us know how to get in touch with those videos so we can go back and watch them. So we've done that for you guys.
Yeah. So go back to that. There you go. Right there. Hey, you can QR scan that code right there. And that will give you our YouTube page, which is, again, you'll see all those videos right there. That's really cool. And so that's something we just put up.
Yeah. So tonight is a fun topic. It's date night.
Yep.
Yes.
Come on.
And so we just want to ask you guys, what are some of your fun date nights or dates? Please do not put in there Jamaica or Hawaii. Let's focus on our Georgia dates, right?
Yeah. The area around us. And we want to get, you want to hear your creative date nights that you guys have done.
Yeah.
So you guys can give some ideas to other people as well, because we want to see what those things are like. And as you guys are putting those in there, we're going to go ahead and just share a couple of our date night experiences as well.
Yes.
The chat up here.
So Matt and I, we're kind of foodies. We yes. like to try new restaurants. And one of our favorite things to do is for our anniversary every year, we try a new restaurant. And then once we try that new restaurant, in our notes section of our phone, which is actually connected on our phones, our phones are in sync. We have a list of all the 22 places that we have eaten and celebrated our anniversary. And every year we sit down and we ask each other, we kind of quiz each other on if we can remember what year we went to what restaurant. So that's
just really cool. And we
kind of a little bit of a funny thing that we do.
Reminisce our anniversaries for 2 years.
So far. It's getting a little difficult.
So. It's really challenging. And this year was especially crazy on our anniversary. We go out to this restaurant and the valet driver, we give him the keys, they take the car.
Yeah.
And they actually wrecked our car.
Yeah.
So for our anniversary this year, it was actually a really memorable anniversary.
Uh-huh. Very memorable.
And that has anyone ever had that happen before? Your valet driver ever wrecked your car?
Yeah.
I hope not. So
only the Rigsby's.
But a couple date nights that I thought were really, really cool.
Yes.
So there was one time I told Angel, I said, hey, I want to take you on a date night. We're going to go to an Atlanta Braves game. And she thought I was joking.
I laughed.
She laughed at me. She's like, really? I don't want to go to the Atlanta Braves game.
Because it was for my birthday. And I used to be a Braves fan back when I didn't live in Georgia. I was a Braves fan. But anyway, I laughed because I thought he was joking. And so he had to quickly pull together a date night.
So I shifted our date night and it ended up becoming one of our best date nights.
Yes.
And what we did was this, we actually went and into a shooting range and shot guns.
It was
which
fun.
She had never shot guns before.
No.
And so the first time she shot a gun, she started crying. And then
there was so much power. I was like, I can't deal with it.
And then I went to the complete extreme of that and went and took her to have a mani-pedi.
Yes. And we've actually gotten manis and a mani-pedi together.
Which is actually
for
really,
those
really
guys
cool.
out there who have actually went and got a mani-pedi. Or maybe just a mani, or maybe just a petty with their wife. Please put in the chat so that we know there are other guys who have done that.
All right. Let's see what some we've done here. So the Van Gogh traveling expedition. Hey, that's actually here in Atlanta right now. I know
that's
a lot really of people
fun.
Are actually doing that.
Yeah.
Atlanta Fever Candlelight Concerts.
Gorge.
Tallulah Gorge. Yeah.
Yes.
painting pottery. That's something I would like to do. Yeah. That'd be really cool.
We took a cooking class one time and that was really fun.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. Candytopia.
Oh.
I've never been to Candytopia, but I've seen pictures of it.
So if we went to Candytopia, I think that if we came home and our kids found out we went there without them, I think that we would probably end up paying for that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
that's, here's the thing. Date nights are all about fun.
I saw axe throwing. Sorry.
Axe throwing for a date. That's really cool.
Sorry. That just totally distracted
me. You definitely don't want to be upset at one another when you go do that. So date nights are really supposed to be cool and supposed to be fun.
Yeah.
You know, and we have those date nights where we just go out to dinner and maybe go watch a movie. We haven't really watched movies much on date nights in a long time.
No.
But
well, I think a lot of that is we want to make sure that we're not sitting shoulder to shoulder while we're on a date. We want to be face to face. And when you're shoulder to shoulder and you're watching a movie, there's not a lot of emotional connection. Yeah. But if you're face to face, there's a lot of emotional connection. So.
And so with that, I would say probably some of the coolest date nights we've done were ones that we were very intentional about.
Absolutely.
And this was where we were intentional about our questions and what we talked about and how we interacted in our relationship. And so with that, we've actually put together for you guys a date night. And I think Lanice is going to share you the screen with that. You can, in fact, this date night is actually a football themed date night. We presented this here a few weeks ago. And
we had the guys in mind when we put this here together.
So in fact, just text date night to 203040. You can get this. Now, here's the cool piece about that. We actually broke this date night down into four different quarters, just like football. And there's a halftime show. And so here, if you actually participate in this date night before September, I think it's September 19th, and you do the actual halftime show in there, you actually get, I guess, put into a drawing to win a $200 Frankie's gift card. And so now
has their phone out and they are texting 203040. They're texting right now. They're saying, I'm going to figure out what this halftime show is and how I can win. Right.
And I'll tell you, not that many people have done this. So really, you know, just probably a handful of y'all do it. Your odds of winning this are actually pretty good. And by the way, if you've never been to Frankie's, it is, in my opinion,
it's amazing.
The best steakhouse in Atlanta. Awesome. In fact, I hope no one does this so we get the Frankie's gift card.
I don't think that's going to happen.
Be really nice.
I don't think that's even going to happen.
And so, but anyway, check that out. But also, not only did we put that date night together, and by the way, try to do that before September 19th. We have another date night that we actually put together, an XO marriage. If you don't know XO marriage, XO marriage is with Jimmy Evans. And so they did a XO marriage conference in Houston earlier this year. And so we're going to do the simulcast version of that. We're going to show what we thought was the best, some of the best messages from that, just a few of the best messages. And we're going to have a dinner. And this is going to be, they're hosting it at Hamilton Mill. So this will not be at Norcross. It's going to be at Hamilton Mill, but it's only $50. And in that you get way more than you get food. You get, we get some, a little booklet and some stuff. And we have great night that night.
And it's an in-person event.
In-person
only.
Event.
Yeah.
And so if you've been looking forward to some kind of a marriage conference or marriage get together, this is it right here. We're doing it. We're limited capacity on what we can have for this. I think we only have 75 seats. Or sorry, 75 70, couples.
I think it's 70 at this point.
Yeah, 70 couples at this point. And so with that, we're going to make you aware of that as well. And so we'd love for you guys to join us there.
That's right. And then also tonight, you know, we usually give something away. And tonight we are actually going to give away a date to Top Golf. So if you and your spouse love Top Golf or love to golf, this is what you need to do. We are actually going to watch a video tonight. And on that video, you're going to see some familiar faces. And in this video, someone's going to say something and we're going to come back at the end of the evening. We're going to ask you a question. And the first person to get that answer correctly is going to win that $100 gift card to Topgolf.
Topgolf. Yeah. So, hey, tonight we are watching a video. It's your best date night in. It was put on by some friends of ours, Ted and Nancy Lowe. And Ted is, he oversees a ministry called Married People here in Atlanta, Georgia, and is doing some great things for marriage. And so we're really excited about that. And so in this entire night tonight is all around date night. And they're going to ask some questions. And so as they ask questions tonight, put your answers in the chat.
That's right.
And so we want to be following along and be a part of this as much as we can. This is a really cool video. And like Angel said, you're going to see some familiar faces here with us tonight. And so with that, let's go ahead and begin.
Awesome.
You guys ready?
All right.
All right.
Hey guys, we are Ted and Nancy Lowe.
Welcome to your best night in. We've been married for 25 years. We've been working with married couples for 20 of those years.
No, we have not been working with married couples for 20 years. You have. I have been working with Excel spreadsheets and Ubering the people that live at this house, like normal people, like probably most of the normal people watching. I'm normal like you.
You're not completely normal. Have you seen yourself on stage?
Okay, that's true, but all the other stuff is super normal.
Anyway, we both believe that marriage is supposed to be great.
And it's supposed to be fun, and that's what this date night in is all about.
Welcome to your best night in.
I have been a recording artist since 1995 with a little song called This Is How We Do It.
Been married 26 years, yeah. And we have kids galore from 32 to 8.
And grandkids, two grandbabies. Yeah. But when it comes to parenting and when it comes to marriages and all of that, we hope we get to spend some time to understand why this should be fun.
If you're not having fun, what are we doing?
We live in Seattle, Washington, and we've got a couple of boys. We've got a college kid. We've got a high school kid. We've been married for 36 years.
I'm a psychologist.
I'm a marriage and family therapist.
So we write books and we speak, and we founded eHarmony with Neil Warren and Symbis Assessments and lots of other stuff.
We have been married for almost 18 years, and we have two children. We run Marriage 365 because we love to help couples.
We've been married for an amazing
20 years.
Whoop, don't stop, get it. Yes, so this wonderful woman has given birth to 6 kids. So I travel the country and internationally doing stand-up comedy and speaking.
If you have multiple children, you don't put all of them in athletics at the same time. Yo, we had 2 in soccer, 2 in football, 4 different teams, and everybody made the playoffs. I was praying that they lost. Lord, let them lose in the name of Jesus. Victory is yours, keep it to yourself today. God, I don't want to slice another orange. I don't want to see another Gatorade. I don't want to stab another Capri Sun. God, I just want my Saturdays back.
Terry and I, we travel and do marriage conferences. What do you call what we do, baby?
We do marriage DNA.
We're James and Lisa Duvall, and we have the privilege of looking after the married people at Christ Fellowship Church.
In sunny South Florida.
That's right.
We've been married 27 years. We have 3 kids, 2 young adults and one 15-year-old and loving every minute of it.
Okay.
Do you think the kids know we're leaving?
Okay, so we are going on our own date right now, right?
Yes.
This is our date night. But we are going to be asking questions during our date. And so we've asked questions of some marriage experts and some friends of ours that are normal like me. And
are you saying I'm normal again?
Mm-hmm, a little bit. Okay. Well, you know, marriage expert, normal people. So we're going to answer the questions as well. And we hope you guys will answer the questions.
Yeah, that's how this is gonna work.
Okay, so question number one. Why do you think fun can be a challenge for married people?
Sometimes it's hard for us to have fun because we're just so busy with our life.
I would say kids.
Kids is number one.
You have three kids.
And two and three.
Sometimes it's just even mentally and emotionally, be honest with you, depending on what's going on in your head and your heart.
We work hard with no play.
Right.
I think that's what we just, brought up to, just work hard all the time.
Well, I think there's lots of reasons. I think there's busyness. I think there's the seriousness of life. I think there's those things called kids. Lots and lots.
Just tired.
And lots of things.
Just being tired, and it feels so extra.
Part of the reason is we get stuck in a rut. I think that's one of the biggest reasons that we miss out on fun, is we just kind of go through life with our head down, and we need our spouse to come alongside and jostle that a little bit just to help us see, hey, there's a different perspective here that can be pretty funny.
The number one thing we'd say is busyness.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, crowded schedules, overcommitments. I mean, it's hard to have fun when you're just busy all the time.
Which then makes you tired.
For a lot of people, fun is something that you don't think you should have intent to do. We think fun is just something that kind of happens haphazardly or on accident.
And this is the thing. If you started it off like that, don't you think that if you want to get back to the thing that's the most basic, which was, guess what? You fell in love with them because they were fun.
I hope you did.
If you didn't, what were you doing?
My God, that'll preach right there.
What do you call it?
Sex.
Sex. Woo-hoo! Just the lack thereof, just creates this tension. Mm-hmm. And as we always say, you can't have fun if you don't bring none.
For young couples with trying to make their careers and move ahead, and then maybe limited finances, it's hard for them to figure out how to have fun. We also just saw one of our favorite couples just today that he had kind of misunderstood what fun was, because mm-hmm. he thought tickling her was fun, and she didn't find that too fun.
We've heard outside family members, they haven't really leave and cleave. They haven't been able to do
parents.
That.
Even ex-spouses. Or just the blended family aspect. Yes.
I think another big one that we hear is resentment. A lot of couples have unforgiveness towards one another, or one spouse is carrying resentment. And so, gosh, the idea of even being able to laugh and have fun and connect emotionally is overwhelming because they're just weighted down by that unforgiveness.
I think a lot of couples struggle with just the ability to have fun and play. Like, just to let their guard down. I think being an adult can just wear on us, and we don't know how to have fun anymore.
It's true. I think too, people have insecurities. I think if you don't feel confident about yourself and your spouse makes a joke or they suggest something that would be out of the normal everyday things that you do, that can make you feel really insecure.
The husband may always being super opinionated and always giving his opinion to the spouse, to his wife, and that's driving her down, discouraging her, or the wife is consistently giving her strong opinion to the husband, and that's just driving him berserk, bananas, or discouraging.
Recently, I was talking to a young bride. She's like, our date nights are just not any fun. We're having a hard time having fun. So I'm like, what's going on? Let me help you out, girl. And she said, well, I've been talking to him about the things that are really frustrating about our relationship right now. And I'm like, I think I've discovered why you're not having fun.
Yeah.
This is not the time to have a conversation about what's going wrong in your communication, what's going on with the kids, and so-and-so needs therapy and all that kind of stuff. Not time for work, it's time for you, time for you guys to have a blast. So I'm like, I wanna know your next 5 dates. What are you gonna do to have fun?
One of the insights that really helped us sort of figure out how can we get over this hump about, man, life is work and seriousness and problem solving, is to realize you can bring playfulness in to even the most serious moments. And it doesn't have to be all saved up for some big bang of spectacular fun.
I got her because I made her laugh.
That's a fact. 6'8", he stood, and the grandeur of going into the full running man. For those of you who are a little younger and not as seasoned, yes. Okay, that in a 6'8 format in the middle of a club where all eyes go, whoosh, I was like,
yeah, we met in a club, like I said, because we started out nasty. But God redeemed everything that we was doing back then. And the point is this, you have to be able to go back to the things that made you laugh. You had to go back to the things that you had fun, the things that were enjoyable. And when you're able to do that, most people are looking forward so much that you forget the things that God has done.
What about you? Why do you think fun can be a challenge for married people? Hit pause to answer the question, or just keep riding along with Ted and Nancy.
So we got to answer the question.
Right.
And the amount of time that it takes us to get through the line.
Okay.
Which is about 12 seconds.
Okay, so what is the number one challenge to having fun in your own marriage?
I would say...
So our marriage.
Yes. What do you say?
I think just being tired.
I know.
I gotta get stuff done before I have fun. That's just kind of in my nature, not for you.
No, I'm not about tasks. I do not even make a to-do list. I wouldn't even, I'd lose it before I got to the, you know, scratching something off phase. But I'm all about people, and fun centers around people for me. You could interrupt me to do anything connecting at any point.
Season and priorities for a mom. We have a teenager, so we are trying to manage schedule with that, getting her places, that kind of stuff. So our season right now, and I have my mother in town and we haven't seen her for a year. So she's coming here to spend time with us and it's messing up our fun.
Mother-in-laws are a lot of fun though.
Well, yes, they are.
It's when Terry is doing the passenger seat or backseat driving. And that's no shade, ladies. Yeah.
Well, the real question is, can we call it driving?
Even when our marriage was falling apart and we were nearing divorce, I mean, we hated each other. The one thing and the surprising thing we look back at is we've always had fun.
Yeah.
In fact, that would probably be the one thing that kept us going and was the motivating factor to work on our marriage.
Yeah, of course. And I mean, through the years, how many games of Rummy have we played? We've played Mario Kart. We find ways to have fun.
Yeah.
I don't think there's a time we walk by an arcade and we're not like, hey, let's go play a quick game or something like that.
Yes.
And that's, I love that about you. I'm a fun guy naturally. I'm gravitating to fun. I'm an Enneagram 7. So everything I see through life is like, how much fun can we have in this experience?
And we're both people where we are not, we don't want our lives to be all work and no play.
Yeah.
Like for us, like we work hard, but we play hard. And yeah. I think that that's something that we've always had in our marriage, that we've always said, no matter what happens, let's connect. And usually it's over a card game or a board game at night. But that's the one area, the one, because all the other areas we messed up on, that we've always connected with.
I would say the biggest challenge is we're not thinking that fun is equated in what we are allotting time for. In other words, I will allot time to make sure my kids get to school, or that we go to this game, and I use time to do this, and I use time for an interview, I use time to travel. We use time for everything, but most people don't have fun listed on the calendar.
There's a particular beach that we love going to, and the name of this beach is called Point No Point. And there's a history behind that with the sailors that have had crashes there and stuff. But Anyway, getting on a ferry and being very spontaneous
about
this.
It's all about the process.
It's like 45 minutes away from where we live.
Yeah, it's doable, but it's like you're entering a fun zone
right.
when you get on that ferry.
And we say the point of no point exactly.
Here we are, our marriage is falling apart, and fun was the thing that was actually motivating us and giving us hope to continue. And I remember Casey connects when doing activities.
Yeah.
He would bring defenses down when he would be having fun. Me too, but definitely more so you. And so even like on an average day, right, we'd get in a little tiff, some time would pass, a couple hours would move on, and then you'd say, hey, do you want to play a game of Mario Kart? Or do you want to go on a hike? Or we had a pool table, not in our house, but in our apartment complex, and he'd say, do you want to go play some pool? And we would, and we wouldn't talk about our marriage. We would just laugh and even sometimes be quiet and in our thoughts, but it was a really great way for us to have fun in those small moments of hope in our marriage.
My refrigerator had busted a hose, flooded the entire middle basement, floor, and then the basement is flooded. They have to come and rip up the floors and the ceiling.
No fun.
In the midst of all of that, you have to take a time to be silly and not take yourself so seriously. Otherwise, it'll make you crazy. Like all of my stuff everywhere, that makes me crazy. I like order. I like peace. So I personally like to bust into spontaneous song or dance or be silly. Or we have timeouts or breaks for things like that.
One of the things we're faced with right now, we have a teenage daughter who's learning to drive. So this causes me a lot of stress on me. So it is hard for me to have fun when I'm dealing with that and getting her places.
When I have this perspective, that's the dude's perspective and 100 man perspective, and those perspectives clash, neither one of them is wrong. They're just a different perspective. And that tension, when that stuff shows up, fun, there's no such thing as fun.
And I think too, so much times when you're hurting in your marriage, it's all about feelings and working through things. And it's really hard and mundane and it's so emotional. Mm-hmm. So that to know that there's a little bit of play and a little bit of fun in those seasons is really motivating to keep going. And also a reminder, that's right, when we were dating, we did have fun together.
I think fun actually generates hope for your relationship. Because you're like, through it all, yes, we've got some really ugly parts that we're dealing through, working through. We can still find this part where we're happy and we can escape to this part. We just leave some of those worries behind. I think we need that more.
That's so true. It gives you hope.
Yeah.
So yeah, so that just the challenge of just getting in sync with when we feel that sort of release in our spirits that it's time to have fun and it's okay to have fun. Yeah.
And so in the instances where a basement floods or a relative gets sick or you got friends that are navigating through the loss of a family member, all of those things, that's life. And that happens. And when you have to navigate those curveballs, that's the place where you have to counter by making sure that you are able to stay silly, you're able to stay goofy. In other words, that means you got to keep the laughter, man. I think there's a scripture somewhere that talks about God is dancing and rejoice and singing over us.
Zephaniah,
and if he's doing it, come on, Zephaniah, come on, pastor.
Hey,
sexy pastor. All right. But for that Zephaniah, that's a scripture that we go to course correct, to remind us that in the midst of a storm, that God is not absent of it. He's there with us in that storm. And from that standpoint, we make it our priority to keep laughing, to keep smiling, to keep singing, to keep dancing. And those things help keep us joyful.
What about you? What is the biggest challenge to having fun in your own marriage? Hit pause to answer the question, or just keep riding along with Ted and Nancy on their way to places too famous to name.
What?
No, thank you. No,
what?
Thank you. No, thank you.
We can walk around. We can dream of things
you.
That I could build.
Mm-mm.
We could look
thank you.
Barbecue no, grills and chainsaws and lumber.
Lovely.
Who doesn't love lumber? I can pour it.
Mm-hmm.
that is. So
I put my mind to it. I can do anything off of YouTube.
Okay, no tension.
Did you take a bubble
bath? So, next question. Does God have anything to say about the importance of having fun as a couple?
Yes, he does.
I think that God intends marriage to be enjoyed. Mm-hmm. And I think that one of the ways to enjoy your marriage is to have fun with one another.
I think so too. I think that's a good answer.
I think he may define fun the way we would, and that's any way that we can connect in a way that makes, again, makes us laugh, makes us enjoy each other. Enjoying each other in the context of marriage.
Oh, but this isn't fun.
Oh. This. I'll be quick.
No, this is not a true statement.
What if you put me on a timer?
What and if I just put you out?
Oh, that's not fun.
Oh, that's tough. Okay, so, all right. Okay. So,
I'll get you an icy at the end.
You give me an icy? I'm sold. Okay, I'm sold.
Okay. It doesn't take much. Not at all. You are a sweet, sweet, kind man, Ted.
I'll try.
God is all about fun. He made the duck-billed platypus.
Who does that?
Who does that? You had to have a fun God.
He made the jackfruit. What was that about?
Well, I don't know what that was.
I mean, he could have stopped at the kiwi. I don't know. It's just me. I'm good.
Yeah, I think when we meet God, I think we're going to be surprised by his sense of humor, right? And I don't even think it's talked about enough on Sunday mornings. I mean, Jesus knew how to attend parties, make everyone feel comfortable, make everyone feel at ease, which, you know, if you take yourself too seriously, you know, you're not going to be able to find playful moments in life. And one of the things I love, I was just actually reading the Chronicles of Narnia to my kids, and the magician's nephew, the creation of Narnia, Aslan actually says, in my kingdom, there'll be as much joking as there will be justice. And I love that concept.
I think too, and I'm sure all the ladies could agree with me on this. I mean, inside of your adult husband is like a 14-year-old boy who laughs and giggles at his farts. I mean,
yes.
We also have these moments that God knew we were going to fart, we were going to burp, we were going to accidentally trip over things. And I think that those things are funny moments. I mean, if you're a parent, your kids do and say inappropriate things, silly things, bizarre things, and it's so cute and funny. And I think he knew that we would be just full of laughter and joy of just the everyday things that happen.
The first thing that comes to mind is enjoy the wife of your youth. I mean, that's scripture, right? So.
Yeah, absolutely. God, if the Bible says to enjoy the wife of your youth,
that means drive correctly.
Let her breast satisfy you at all times like a doe. But then it's, you know, you see in the scriptures where it says, beware of the foxes, the little foxes that destroy the vine. That means get rid of those irritants that can destroy and frustrate your marriage. Let's clear the table so it can be set to have fun.
Hey, having sex is fun.
It should be.
Well, of course, I hope
it
is.
If it's not, the good news is you can learn how to have fun in the bedroom.
Yeah, exactly.
That's the good part, is if you're not having fun, there's hope you can learn how to. Because we weren't always having fun in the bedroom.
I was.
Something James and I talk about often with couples is the idea of joyology. There's theology around joy, and there's nothing about the nature of God that says he's about marriage being a ball and chain or being no fun or dreaded. It's about having fun. The John 10:10 life, the full, abundant life, overflowing life, isn't for later, it's for now, and it's not just for church, it's for relationships.
Yeah, it's not just about a full spiritual life, it's about a full physical life while we're here.
Actually, it's one of my favorite things about faith.
that Jesus actually talks about giving us the gift of joy. That I've come so that your joy would be full and complete. And so we know, because this marriage relationship models that relationship, God wants our marriages to be infused right. with as much joy as absolutely possible.
In the pursuit of happiness, God doesn't promise happiness. He promises joy.
Yeah.
And he promises a joy, unspeakable joy, that's on the inside of us. And so when the world is chaotic and the world is crazy, happiness is what's on the outside that affects who we are on the inside. But joy is what happens on the inside that affects who we are on the outside.
When Jesus said, "I've come to give life and give it to the full," that we think it's sometime after this life, but really, you know, everything that God has given to us, he's a giver of good gifts, and he gives us a full life today. And so we should be experiencing it in all aspects of our life.
Right. And it's not after this season gets over. The season, whatever season we're in, if we're a married couple with small kids, married couple that your kids are driving you nuts because they're driving, or your in-laws are in town, it's joy in all of that. It's not joy for later after this season or that season, but it's joy for right now, today, and tomorrow.
That's right.
God did not give us marriage so that it would make us happy, yeah. right?
As shocking as that thought is.
Yeah, and that's a challenge for a lot of newlyweds. I thought, I'm supposed to be happy now. This is, where's the joy, right? We make our marriage happy, right?
Yeah.
That's up to us to do that with the Holy Spirit in our life. But I think that God is so invested in having us do that. There's an old Yiddish saying, I think it's something about God. Someday God's gonna hold you accountable for all the joyful things that you didn't partake in,
right?
We always, you know, get this mindset or mentality that our spirituality is all gotta do the right thing and be the right person, but it's also enjoying, savoring, experiencing things that bring joy into the world and into our marriage.
Yeah, like I always say, don't take yourself too seriously.
Absolutely.
You know, the little things can be overlooked sometimes that would cause frustration, that can cause bigger issues to come in your marriage that robs you of joy, that robs you of fun.
Yeah, and I think another underlying thing is when in the garden, where it says they were naked and not ashamed. There's something about being naked,
being open with each other.
Well, nakedness is good too, but I'm
being
just saying, there's this mental nakedness of, here I am, I'm not trying to hide anything from you. I'm not embarrassed, I'm not ashamed. And when I have those things, it sets the table.
A lot of couples watching this right now, you may not be having fun because you think fun is something external. And fun is not external. Fun is based on joy that is internal, that comes from him, and the peace that is inside of us that passes all understanding. And when we have joy, that then exudes out of us, and we're able to have fun, because although the circumstances may be flooding around you like in the next room, it doesn't matter what's happening. A shout out to Dwayne Johnson. It doesn't matter what's going on in your life, because the fun is coming from joy and not based on some external circumstance.
Yeah, and I think it's so honoring to God, because the savoring, like you said, is really what brings us full circle to gratitude. And so absolutely. When our marriages have that quality of fun and playfulness, and then savoring the things that we delight in together, then they're filled with gratitude. That in turn draws us to each other.
Yeah.
Because we know because we are researchers. We're a little bit of the nerd thing when it comes to marriage.
Speak for yourself.
We know that there's a negativity bias that we have to fight. Our brains hold on to the bad stuff. It clings to us like Velcro. And so we really have to go after, and that's why I think God weaves in joy and weaves in gratitude as just making it a point in our faith. We have to go after that so that we infuse our life with that.
Terry did this thing that I said I didn't want to happen in our marriage.
Okay, I'll tell you, I bought a lamp.
Now, see, you telling people that, now they're going to think that. Hey,
we're being honest here, right?
Right, yeah. So, yeah, we are. Good deal. I just saw people in my family buy things, and they would hide it from each other. And I just didn't like that. I'm like, man, why do they hide stuff? So I'm like, hey, I saw this. I always want you to feel free. Whatever you buy, don't feel like you got to hide it. Well, early on, Terry bought something, and I went into our baby room that we were fixing up, and I found some purchased items. I was hurt, frustrated, and upset. And when I brought it to her attention, she asked you, like, you know what? I did, and I'm sorry. The next day, I went to work. I'm coming home. And I got ready to go in the house, and I was still burning up. I can't believe she did this. I'm going to go in the house, and I'm going to show her that she can't do that. I'm not going to say anything. Straight silent treatment. And as I'm getting out of the car, the Lord brought this verse to mind where it says, husbands, don't be embittered towards your wives. I was like, oh, snap. I was about to go into the house, holding this thing that she had done wrong, or holding this thing that I felt like she had violated in our relationship. And since the Lord grabbed hold of me and let me know that I was being bitter, I walked in the house, and instead of having a heavy moment, we actually had a fun moment. Ha! Now that's, ever since then, I recognized that bitterness or unforgiveness in a marriage prevents fun. And we like fun.
Like, there's no systematic theology chapter on the jokes of God. Like, I wish there was. I wish there was some sense of, like, you know, the theology of God's sense of humor, that he would mash up a boy and a grown woman and throw them together and say, create a family together and, like, try to work through in-law issues. And
that's why when wives get bills all worked up and they're really serious, I'm like, you have to understand that inside your husband is a little boy who just wants to have fun and play and giggle. And until you embrace that, and I think it's so good when God gives a woman a son, because I think she gets that.
Do you think fun has to be something that's just inherently, you know, a fun, enjoyable activity? But we can sometimes have the most fun when we're just rolling up our sleeves, working hard on a project, and we get lost in it. And because it's so meaningful, then we just feel like, man, that was the most fun we've had in a long time.
And I will tell you this, Martin Seligman, who's an incredible psychologist, president of the APA and all that, he did this experiment that I've replicated many times in our general psychology class that we teach at the university. And that is to have students make a list of all the things that would be fun to do. And they write, go to the movies, play Xbox, have ice cream, all that kind of stuff. And then make another list of ways you can add value to other people's lives. Oh, well, I could give blood. I could help this woman that never seems to have anybody to help her in her garden. I can, you know, and they make a list of all. And then they assign half the class. We assign half the class to go do the fun stuff, others to go do the thing where they're adding value to other people's lives. And then we give them a sophisticated assessment, a measure of happiness. Which group do you think is happy? This is pretty leading, right? Of course, it's not the group that went out to have dedicated fun.
Just to do the inherently pleasurable thing.
Right, yeah. And so anyway, I think that that's part of the path. When you're walking the path with Jesus, when you're walking down a godly path, you find meaning. And that's at the truest source of abiding joy, right? It's not because, oh, we got to go do a fun thing right now. It's in finding the meaningful things that fun finds you.
How do I get joy? Right? Because a lot of people, we talk about joy, but sometimes we don't understand where it comes from. It can only come from God. It says there's fullness of joy in God's presence. And without his presence, there isn't joy. So is the thing. How do we allow joy to come into our heart? We have to spend time in his face. Yeah. We have to spend time with him in order to have that joy. It's his presence that brings joy, and joy is on the inside. So it doesn't matter what's happening around us, that's happiness, but joy is from the inside, which can only come from God.
And joy leads to fun.
We had a couple mentor us in this a little bit, and they taught us that it can be really fun to do service together in secret. Yeah. And that added this element of delight to it. So nobody even knows we're doing it, but we're doing something really kind together. And that just added this whole new wrinkle of fun.
Shared service in secret. Yeah. So we find somebody that needs something that we know about, and we don't even necessarily let them know about it, but we help them meet that need. And nobody knows but the two of us.
It's such right? a blast, honestly.
Yeah, so meaning, don't neglect that when it comes to finding fun. Yeah.
What do you think? Does God have anything to say about the importance of having fun as a couple? Hit pause to discuss, or just keep on rolling.
Okay, you ready for the next question?
What'd you say? Sorry. Trying to drive.
I know, but we're doing questions.
Carpool karaoke when you're actually on a trailer. Like, I'm legit driving right now.
Okay.
Okay.
Are you ready for the next question?
I am okay. ready.
What do you do to have fun in your marriage?
I mean, have sex.
Wow.
You know, we like to go out to the movies, or we do a lot of staycations. You know, we
we love staycations.
We love going to hotels.
Vacations are fun mm-hmm. with just the two of us.
One of the things we do to have fun as a couple is travel. And sometimes when there's lots of time off, that's international travel, but sometimes it's as simple as going to check out a new neighborhood in the city where we live.
We cook together sometimes.
We do.
That's fun. Hiking, yeah. Messing with our kids, playing pranks on them.
That's fun.
Generally, when we get outside of our comfort zone or do stuff that's outside of what's routine, that's really fun for us. But then again, we're watching Survivor tonight, which we do most weeknights.
Yeah, and sometimes I think we rediscover new activities or old activities we have not done in a while. So for example, we say, you know what, we haven't done any kind of bike riding in a park, or we haven't done go for a walk somewhere, and we just do things like that, and it makes it fun and interesting and new for both of us.
I feel like we're pretty good at this.
We usually don't get to say that, do we?
But it helps that you and I think each other is super funny, and we have discovered our mutual love of memes.
Yes, our version of love notes. Yeah, I really always feel understood by you when you send memes, like for the situation, and go, she gets me because this was the perfect.
Yes, this said what I was thinking in my heart.
We do lots of silly things like scare each other. That's my favorite thing. When Jason comes home from a trip, I'll hide under a desk.
So, and sometimes practical jokes are very risky. It's like a joke. It's either this is gonna land or it's gonna bomb. Like the other day, we were cleaning out our garage, and she was with the kids, she was sweeping, and I decided to start the camera, and I got the leaf blower as she was sweeping up dust with her new Sister Lock hairdo.
We were married 14 years yeah. before we actually had kids.
We call those our single years.
Yeah, back when we were single. And we used to laugh at people who had to have a date night. Right. You know, we were so naive. Yeah.
Every night's a date night, right? We're having a blast.
Yes.
We put stakes to winnings. Well, hey, if you win this game, or the winner gets a massage for 10 minutes, or the winner gets to pick the sex position tonight. Like, we make it fun when we play games, but we're both competitive. Yeah. And I was also gonna say sex. We have sex, like, it's fun.
It is fun.
We make it very playful and very fun. We love to exercise. We live by the beach, so we go on walks to the beach all the time. We love to take our dog on walks as well. We surf, we go swimming. Yeah. We have lots of fun.
Yeah, we do.
How do you keep something fresh when you're doing the same thing day after day, mm-hmm. right? So you gotta take it up a notch, whether that's get new lingerie, play games.
I just like the word lingerie. I'm sorry. Some of y'all too holy out there. We do Monopoly. We do movie nights. We try and take everyday activity and make sure it doesn't become monotony. We try and make sure that we're doing things that don't set you into so much of a routine that it becomes something that you have to do. It becomes something that you get to do.
One of the other things that we do that I think is so fun that we've been doing for almost 7 years of our 25 years of marriage is we have a week away. We call it Just the Two of Us Trip.
And it's fun.
It is fun. And we set it a year out, and then we always are like, 4 more months. 3 more months, and then when we get to a month, we set down an app that says it counts us down, and it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, because I think some of the fun is in the anticipation of what we're going to do as well. So that's one of the things that we do for fun, and I think spontaneity is another thing we do for fun is whenever we have an opportunity to go grab breakfast together or go grab a coffee together.
So fun for us, it evolves, and we are not as maybe as intentional about it as we used to. We want to find fun in the moment.
Yeah, in other words, we're not as scheduled as we used to be. Right. Now we look for those little playful things that just sort of want to happen on their own, and then we don't miss them. We lean into that.
Yeah.
Thursday is a spontaneous lunch day for us. So I'll just call her up and say, hey, what you doing? Get dressed. Or, you know, we're going out for lunch. We'll run, even sneaking out the house sometimes and getting an apple pie from a restaurant. We're running fast food drive-thrus, just running through the drive-thru, sneaking where the kids don't know, just that sneaky element.
I think especially coming out of hard times, fun is that refuge for us. We need to have that sense of fun. And I think when we're going through tough times, you actually get to look back on those fun moments. And that kind of carries you through those things because you're like, yes, it's tough, but you know, we are going to have fun at some point.
I'm a huge Groupon guy, and it's amazing the kind of experiences that you can do if you just plan out in advance. And that's one of the reasons we plan so far in advance is because you can get amazing deals wherever you are in the financial situation.
During the pandemic, we did this once one night with a puzzle. We had a map of the world, and it was like a cartoon map.
And we're sounding more nerdy all the time. I know.
But it was like 2:30 in the morning, and we looked up and went, oh, we've been at this kind of a long time, yeah. Right?
Mixtapes. Hey, guess what? You can do a Spotify list and it can play and you can dance in the dark. Some of you have a fireplace, fire pit, whatever that may be. Just mix it up. Make it fun.
We define fun as making new memories together. Some people call it date night or going on dates, but really it's not doing the mundane parts of marriage and household chores and parenting, right? That's so much of our lives as adults is rinse, wash, repeat. And if we only do that, we won't be having fun.
It is a sense of building emotional intimacy with your partner. I mean, think about it. You know, emotional intimacy is this interplay of trust and dependence, of safety and security. It's joy and laughter. We all just need that break.
I'm actually not adventurous at all. And James is highly adventurous, and so for like 15 years, he's been going, Lisa, will you cycle with me? Because he's a road bike guy. And I'm like, I'm going to do it. Now, I have a lot of fear of being hit by a car, by lots of anything that could possibly happen. I've already thought about it, threat assessed. And so this year, he got me a bike, and I've been trying to push myself outside of my fear and do something adventurous and fun with James. And I am doing fabulous.
Until you bent your coccyx.
I did actually, which is not a good thing. It's a tailbone issue.
That wasn't fun at all.
I don't know that we should talk about that right now.
I think really knowing your spouse's love language is important because then you can tap into what is fun for them.
So vacuuming is fun for you?
It could be if I've had a long day. Vacuuming absolutely could be rewarding.
Yeah. Yeah. And I
This could be fun for you.
Right. You see how I missed that at first? That's how I miss a lot of things.
Most of us have the feeling that a large portion of our happiness has to do with the circumstances we're in right now.
Yeah, and the research shows, and we have a little diagram in our book, only 10% of our happiness is due to our circumstances.
That is a small slice.
Like how much money we make or whether we get this, you know, break at work or whatever it is.
Even surprisingly devastating circumstances do not have a lasting effect on our overall happiness.
Yeah. A big part of the pie, though, half of it, 50%, is what is just known as our biological predisposition.
Yeah, it's just kind of our set point. Yeah. Everybody operates just our own personal set point of just, you know, are we glass half full, glass half empty kind of people? That's not to discourage you, because there's this giant chunk of the pie that is all about choices.
40%. That's the amazing thing, isn't it? Right. That 40% of our happiness and our joy and our fun, our laughter, comes from the choices that we make.
Which, I mean, that's amazing, because that is within our control. So it's not even so much about who we are or the circumstances. It's how we respond to the circumstances in our life and the choices we make.
Every marriage, no matter how good it is, eventually bumps into something bad. And so it comes down to our choices, our attitude, adjusting to things beyond our control. It's a huge part of having fun, a huge part of happiness.
How about you? What do you do to have fun in your marriage? Hit pause and talk about it. Or not. The choice is yours.
Here they are. I may or may not have accidentally gotten a happy birthday one.
That is some excellent bang for your buck.
Who needs roses that cost $60 when you could spend, what, $12.07? For all of that.
Good job, Ted Lowe. Good job. Well done.
Do we have more questions?
Yes. Oh, sorry. I was enjoying. Oh, I'm basking in my balloon love. Okay. Question: how do you make fun together a priority?
Number one, we make sure that our budget includes a travel fund or a fund. So we make sure that we basically be able to have the monetary means to do it. And also we make it a priority by putting it on our calendars.
I think we can do better at that. I don't think we always make having fun a priority. I mean, usually if we get to the point that we're just tired or we need a break, then we're like, okay, let's go have fun. But we don't always prioritize it, unfortunately, and it's something
that's actually something we really want to work on to do better this year, I think, is to make more time for us to, keep enjoying each other.
And then, you want to say schedule?
You don't want to say that word? Schedule sex. A lot of people are like, oh, I want it to be spontaneous. I'd rather be sexually active than spontaneous.
Just say it.
I'm just saying.
If it doesn't make it on your calendar, it probably will not make it in your life.
Yeah.
And so that doesn't feel very fun to be scheduled. But if we don't schedule it, life will take over, interruptions will take over, kids will take over, and then we don't want to end our marriage when our kids leave the house not to know how to have fun.
You know, from every beginning marriage to people who've been married for decades, one of the things that we think is instrumental, and we talk with couples about this, is you have to invest in each other. You have to invest laughter. You have to invest time. You have to invest intimacy. All of those different pieces become
the thing to pull from. Other things are vying for that time.
That's right.
Other things want that space. Your job wants that space.
I think here's the thing to understand. If you don't prioritize it, it will not happen. It's not going to happen. So you have to make some distinctions. Even if you don't put it in your on your calendar or reminder in your phone, there has to be something set in your mind every day or every week that you're going to do. Sometimes ask yourself, have I made my spouse laugh? When's the last time we had a good laugh together?
You got to study your spouse's funny bone. Yep. What you know, what will predict an incredible laugh from them, right? Maybe it's some funny voice that you do. Maybe it's reciting some line from a movie that you just drive into the ground.
Or just bringing up some inside joke.
Right. I know what will always make her laugh. Anytime I can tell her a story where I did something embarrassing, like on a phone call, like or a Zoom call, whatever, she just thinks that's the greatest thing that ever happened. So that's...
Humiliation makes me laugh. Yeah.
So we make fun a priority by doing this number one thing first. We deal with our conflict. We never allow fights to last longer than like an hour. So if we have an issue with each other, we apologize, we forgive, we rebuild trust.
Well, we check in during our weekly marriage business meeting where we're going through all like the logistics of the week.
Yes.
I think that frees us up to have fun because we've dealt with the schedules, the meal plans, the budgets, when are we doing our date nights?
Yes.
And then we get to show up.
And we actually calendar fun. And I think this is the biggest issue is that so many couples, they work full time. They come home, they make dinner, they're with their kids, and then they're like, what should we do for fun tonight?
One of these days, our kids are going to be out of the house, and it's just going to be the two of us, and we want our relationship not just to be centered around our kids. We want to prioritize relationships so that when they're gone, you're stuck with me, and you know, we still want to have fun.
We have been to many places and many hospitals, and at the end of someone's life, they never, ever, ever say, gosh, I wish I had done one more meeting. I wish I had had one more profit and loss statement. Like, that's not what we hear. But we do hear, I wish I had spent more time with my spouse. It's important that you make your spouse a priority because ultimately, this is your most important relationship, this side of heaven.
Yeah.
And that's worth investing in.
Sometimes, you know, you go out to dinner and a movie, and that's great. That's fun, right?
Even that's a good thing.
It's a good thing. Yeah. But when you do something out of the ordinary, something that you're not used to.
Something novel, something that catches your whole being off guard a little
bit. The research shows that's when you have this brain shower of chemicals that you had when you were first falling in love.
Okay, wait, that's amazing because you can literally recreate that feeling. Your brain gets that same chemistry of falling in love when together you do something just out of the box.
One of the research studies that discovered this, they looked at two groups of couples.
One couple, they literally Velcroed together and they made them go through an obstacle
Velcroed
course.
Velcroed their wrists and their ankles and their hips. And then they had the other group.
Just do a lovely romantic date, dinner and a movie, nothing exciting but lovely.
Yeah.
The couple that did the obstacle course, they felt so in love.
And they couldn't stop talking about it. Could you believe it when we went through that thing, you know, and that kind of stuff. And that's what happens when you bring some novelty into the relationship. That's where true fun is found if you're looking for that kind of excitement.
So a couple date night ideas. We encourage you to take a drive and find a common playlist you like to listen on your music, Spotify. Rent bikes, ride through town.
Take dance lessons. Relive your first date.
Oh, I like that one. Pull out all the ticket stubs.
Yes. Have a naked dinner. Yes, you heard us correctly. Like, eat dinner in the nude. Just try it once before you knock it.
Just once.
Yeah. Pull out old pictures from when you were dating.
A $20 date night. So this is like, you only can spend $20 for a date night.
That's it. No more than that. It's harder than it sounds.
Ooh, build a fort in your living room? Maybe naked? A Nerf gun fight, right?
Yes.
That's super fun.
We do these all the time. We both have Nerf guns, and we bought the extra package on Amazon of bullets. So we have like 400 bullets.
Yes.
It's really fun. But just have ideas already on hand so that when you are looking for ways to incorporate fun into your marriage, you're not having to be creative in the moment.
for me, where spontaneity isn't natural, it's a priority for me to make that something that's okay with me. That spontaneity becomes a priority to allow him to say, hey, put on something. I'm coming to pick you up. I'm on my way from a meeting. I'm picking you up in 15. You know, for me, that is prioritizing the fun.
I think there's a difference between making time for something and taking time for something. Okay. God ain't making the days no longer or shorter. We get 24 hours. That's it. That's what you get. So you can't make time. You can't make any more time. It's what we have allotted. But you can take time from what has been made and given to us. We have to take the time for those meals. Take the time for the conversations.
We have been working with a couple just even recently that they just became empty nesters. They have kids our age, but they don't have a 15-year-old like we do. So we're anticipating empty nest, but it caught them off guard. And they really are struggling to figure out, what did they do together? Their life was wrapped around football games, cheerleading, getting their kids in college, getting them off out of the, getting all the things they need. And they forgot to invest in themselves along the way. And they're trying to find themselves in this moment.
On a weekly basis, start just going on a date together. Your kids are old enough to take care of themselves at this point. So just romance your wife. Make a reservation, go out to dinner once a week, find the breakfast once a week, plan a trip together where it's just the two of you. I mean, we talk about just the two of us trips, and it really is just about the two of us reconnecting, talking about our dreams, talking about our ambitions, talking about our hopes for the future.
Here's something interesting from research. When you look at love over the lifespan and a sense of contentment and happiness between a husband and wife, of course, when you first get married, it's 10 out of 10, right? But you come back to that couple 15, 20 years later, and they have teenagers in their home, and you'll see this huge downtrend, the level of satisfaction, probably the lowest it's ever been in their lives around the time they have teenagers. Not because those teenagers made that happen.
Not the kids' fault.
It's just midlife and other things.
Yeah.
But here's my point. When researchers follow this trend, what happens, it begins to climb back up.
Yeah.
So you have this incredible satisfaction at the beginning, and then it goes in the empty nest kind of period where the level of satisfaction goes off the charts. Social scientists don't even have instruments to measure how happy these couples can be that are working on it at that point. So that's a pretty good,
that's
news,
right? That's hope-giving, right?
Yeah, unless you're a couple that's watching this and you're just starting out, you're going, well, that sounds terrible. We have to go through that whole thing. No, you don't have to go through that.
As long as you're cultivating fun along the way, you do not have to go through that natural organic curve. But if it's happening to your marriage, you know, especially if you're kind of just hitting that upswing in the second half of married life, hold on, because you're just getting to the great stuff, and be intentional.
What about you? How do you make fun together a priority? You know the drill. Pause it and talk it, or just forget it and keep going.
Okay, so are you ready for the last question?
I'm ready.
What is the hope for every couple who makes time for fun?
When we bring the fun in, it reminds us again how much like we're friends.
And I think Jesus talks about living life. He came to give us life more abundantly. And it's like, well, what does the more abundant life look like? I think it's full of joy, full of laughter, full of fun.
Hopefully it shows our kids that they too can have fun in their marriage.
Because we have fun together, I think you're still my best friend. And
absolutely.
I like hanging out with you.
Absolutely.
I would hang out with you if I didn't have to.
Yeah. I think so too. Same thing for me.
I think there's so much hope there. You know, we were talking even last night, talking about when we make time for fun, it kind of prepares us when things aren't fun. Right? Like you're kind of, you get to them, you go,
when life happens.
Life happens, you're like, oh, we got some deposits in the bank.
One of the things I think fun makes for marriages is it really makes the things that aren't so fun about life, some of the mundane things, some of the normal rhythms of things, even some of the times when we don't actually agree, which is very rarely.
Very rarely.
But I think the fun things add life to that. And we live from one fun moment to the next, and it gets us to the other, through the other season.
When you just laugh, it just changes the dynamic. It changes the atmosphere. And I remember one time we were doing an event for married people, and one of the couples came to us after the event, and they said, you know, our marriage was almost over, and we came to this event, and we saw couples laughing, and we realized it's okay to laugh, and it changed our marriage.
When you recognize that you don't have to do anything for God to be pleased with you, you don't have to work for God's grace, you're working from His grace. When we recognize that, we are then reconciled to God. And when a man and a woman can be reconciled to God, they can be reconciled to each other.
Human nature needs breaks. We need seasons, time to just refresh and circle back. And they're very authentic, because when you say, okay, we've got unfinished business between us, we've got some burdens that are heavy on us, but we're going to take a legitimate time out, and we're just going to go have a blast and just let it heal us, and then we'll circle back around when we're refreshed. I mean, you know how you feel. Even if you have an unsolved issue and you get a good night's sleep, you're a totally different person in the morning. Right. And playfulness does that to the soul of a marriage.
Listen, it's people who have life in prison and on death row, they have recreation fun time set aside for them. So if people in jail, if people in prison have scheduled fun, then you need fun.
All marriages have those bumps in the road. Just recently, Jason and I had a little disagreement about what was said or whatever. And I had to fight through to have fun with him. I had to fight through my feelings and fight for what was true, what was right, what was lovely, what was of good rapport. And to really get back to the place mentally where I could just relax and be able to accept what he says and not have an attitude because of something that we had not agreed on just earlier. But to really fight for what was going to release me from the bitterness, from the anger, from the, you know, the upset moment. So we could get back to just having fun, to being friends.
You know, if you're hurting and you're trying to find fun in your relationship, I know that can feel really hard, because you're not going to feel like, oh, I want to have fun with this spouse that I'm really angry and upset with. But the reality is that when we got married, we choose love. It is a conscious choice for us to make that choice. And so if you are kind of on that fence, I'm going to encourage you to choose to reach out to your spouse and say, you know what, I know we're going through a tough time, but I want us to have fun together, because that's the hope that carries us through these tough times. But you're not going to feel it. It's not going to feel natural. That's why you have to choose love. Choosing love in the midst of tough times may be one of the courageous, most courageous decisions we ever make.
You're valuable to God. You are loved by God. God is celebrating you, and it's not about what you do, but it's about who He is. And when you're able to understand that, some of you may feel like you're not allowed to have fun because of the circumstance. Yeah. I can't be joyful, or I shouldn't smile, or I can't smile. No, but you can. You really can smile, even in the midst of a trial, even in the midst of a storm. You can smile and you can laugh.
And it's important that you do that, because truly, laughter is like one of the best medicines for the heart. A sick heart, it's joy, it's laughter, it's fun that allows that to be lighter.
The couples that go through the toughest times are those that have the strongest relationships on the other side of
that. I'm so glad you said that, because so often we think, man, is our love going to survive this, and what will we be on the other side of this? When the truth is, the couples that have the strongest love each other, not in spite of those hard seasons, but even more because of them. Because they know, I can go the distance with you.
When the scripture said that the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, that's his aim, to destroy every single thing in your life, including marriage. If not, probably that's what he wants to go after first. But the one way to secure the gates or the boundaries around your marriage is by having fun.
And if currently your spouse isn't your best friend, I encourage you to work hard at that relationship. So fight hard to get back to a place where you can enjoy one another.
The God who has reconciled himself to us can fix any marriage. He can make anything better. He can position a family to have the most enjoyable life possible. We get to create those laughter moments, and that's what we hope for you.
What about you? What hope do you think more fun can bring to your marriage? You know the drill. Pause to discuss or just keep watching.
That was fun.
That was fun. We needed it.
We did. Good times. Good times.
Good times, but not ready for it to be over.
We're the big people. We can decide. It doesn't have to be over.
We don't have to go inside, do we?
No.
There's food and water in there.
This is how we do it. This is how we do it. La, 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 la.
Thank you for joining us for your best night in Have Serious Fun Edition. And if you're wondering.
All right. Hey, we hope you guys enjoyed that. And I'm hoping this from watching this tonight that you approach your date nights a little differently, with a little more purpose, a little more intention to have fun in your marriage. Hey, we're gonna give something away here in just a second, so hang on here. But before we do, we just want to tell you about a few things. One is mark your calendar for what was the day?
February 12th.
February 12th. That's where, and by the way, you guys are the first ones hearing about this. This has not been promoted yet. We're going to do our marriage event, big marriage event at Victory, February 12th.
So this is our save the date.
Save the date. So you saw the comedian on there, Jason Earls. He's going to be here for that. So he's going to be at Victory. Him and his wife, Terry, are going to be sharing with us. They're going to be one of the speakers there on February 12th. So we're really excited about that. But hey, we do want to, again, just announce a couple of things that we announced at the beginning, just so everybody gets a chance to hear that. Again, we have tried to put together some date night opportunities for you all. And one of them we've put together is an online date night that you can follow through together. And so it's a football themed date night. And Lenny's, can you share that PowerPoint so we can get the information on that? But
it's actually quite simple. Just text the word date night to 203040 and you will get an email, or you'll get a text right away sending you to a link.
Yeah, so there it is right there. And so, by the way, in that one, there is a halftime show. So there's four quarters and there's a halftime show that you guys can do together. Do that. And we're going to be giving away a $200
Frankie's gift card.
Frankie's gift card for that. Right. And so this is a digital date night for you guys to enjoy, to have fun, to laugh together. And the second one is coming up on October 1st. This is a live event that we're having at Hamilton Mill. And this is it's the EXO conference that was done.
So it's a simulcast. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a simulcast. We took some of the best teachings from that from the EXO conference, and we're watching those. We have a dinner and just a time together, and so we will let you know about that too. That's two things that you guys can do here soon. By the way, the deadline for the Frankie's gift card is September 19th, so we want to remember that.
But no, we thank you guys so much for joining us tonight, and we pray that you guys have an amazing week, and we will see you next month.